So welcome guys after the break. So I'll be speaking on full stack development. So just a quick show of hands, how many of you have encountered this word recently or know about this full stack development? Cool. You want to share your thoughts on what it is? Anyone? Work across the product technologies. Yes? Work from all the layers, from UI to database. Anything else, anything new? T-shaped skills, horizontally, vertically. Yes? Yes? Okay. So yeah, actually all of you are correct. So this gentleman says full stack is what you make out of it. So it's a very generic statement, but I'll be clearing that in coming slides. So full stack can be at any scale in any direction, right? It can be at any level, right? It can be in any team or across teams, right? It can be across companies as well, right? So it's what you make out of it, it's called full stack. So quick intro, I'm Rajat. I am full stack dev at ConfEngine, managing conferences. This conference itself is managed by ConfEngine. And I'm a co-founder and full stack dev at Pull My Ride. It's a carpooling app. And I also teach programming at Hermit Foundation in New Delhi. So it's for underprivileged kids. So a lot to do for a full stack developer. So I started my career 6 years back, and I entered into software industry. Soon I began to realize my fears were outdated skills. Like if I keep working on some skill set, I'll be outdated after a while because the world is changing so fast, and the mobile phones entered that time, smartphones, and it was like accelerated so much. Then another fear was that I would not be able to switch to another company. Like everyone wants to switch to another culture to learn more, to learn something new. If I stayed inside one company or one skill set, it would restrict me to make switches easier. Another thing was, if I was developing some feature, right, I always wanted to know, like everyone of us would want to know what is happening in and around that feature, right, so that we get a full helicopter view of that or a full control of that thing. My perspective was that I always wanted to know end-to-end things so that I could replicate them at my home for my pet projects or even sell it as a freelancer, right? I always wanted to know what is happening from end-to-end. So these fears led me into knowing full stack development. Like till then, I was not sure that if this is full stack development or not, because that term was not that popular at that time. So what I did was I started looking into different, I Googled technologies and what other popular technologies are there in other areas. I started learning them, I read about them, but somehow this was not working because this was fading along with my daily routine. I used to read them, I used to learn them, but it was somehow fading away with time. So then I realized that it's just not about knowing them, it's about building everything. It's not about knowing everything. You have to actually build everything. It's a very slow, I'll use the word painful as well, it's a painful and a slow process, but you have to build it. Remember the day when you started learning driving, right? You had to control the gearbox, the accelerator, the clutch, and the driving wheel. It was very tough on the first day, right? You were like, damn it, I'll not do it. But once you get used to it, it gets into your subconsciousness, and then you start doing it with ease. So that thing I came to know, that it should be building up everything, right? You have to actually have hands-on on it. So how do you do that? You are in a company doing job 8 hours a day, then traveling 2 hours a day, and you ask your manager or your supervisor that I want to learn that technology as well. I want to do this thing with the other peer is doing. He says, no, we already have that guy specialized in that field. We cannot risk the product development. We have hard deadlines. So this was a roadblock for me. But then I thought I could, you know, do my own pet projects. I had those peers in my company where I could get knowledge from, but I could deliver somewhere else apart from my company, or I could pick up freelance projects, or even pick up open source projects to learn, right? So that's where I, you know, started picking up projects from my neighborhood, from my friends, or from anywhere. So because I wanted to build things. So most of the part of this session will be like my experience report on full stack development. Like we all started, it is about what you make out of it. You may have your experiences, but I'm gonna tell my story and see what are the pains and gains in that. So I picked up a project, right? And I was there in the industry for around 6 to 8 months. I soon realized that yes, we need client technologies like iPhone, Android, or HTML. We also need server technologies. We need to know the database as well for storing data, right? So these were the three areas or three nodes I'll call. So what I did was, as a beginner, right, I started learning one of these, right? I spent some time, learned them. Then I went to, you know, server-side technologies. I picked one of these. Because these were the most popular ones that time, right? They may be new technologies, but I just Googled and picked them up. Then again, went to databases, learned about querying, what is indexing and all. But soon I was in the state that, yes, I was jumbling between them and, you know, trying to, you know, build everything after switching again. But this was an aha moment for me, because I had started entering into full stack development, right? And it was an aha moment for me that because I could build end-to-end product myself, right? And I could get the whole picture. One thing this helped me was in my company as well, I could, you know, say in my discussions, tech discussions, that yes, this could happen on the other side as well, because this is the new technology which is coming up. So this was the state that yes, I was jumbling between different technologies, but after a while, I realized that there was a fatigue. And whenever I moved between different nodes, I was breaking something. So my, you know, world was falling apart. Like, I was doing everything right. I was putting in effort and I was putting in time. But most of the full stack developers start this way. But there is something missing in this execution, which will come soon too. It's not about learning programming languages. It's about switching fast. Programming languages are the nodes, right? You have to learn how to switch fast between different contexts, because that is what is required in the real world, right? Today it is some technology, tomorrow it will be some other higher one. But you need to learn the art of switching between them. It is not about the endpoints, but it is about the transition between them. So let's go back to the same problem. This time, in the beginning, I still know that these are the technologies which I need to cater to. But instead of focusing on the nodes, I focused on the connecting threads or the fabric or the pathways between different nodes. And how to focus on the pathways? The focus is like building them around guiding principles, putting good standards, which are abstract, but they are the DNA of your system. They are not your system. You're designing the DNA that how you will work. An important thing in this picture is, if you see, there is a cushion around every node. So this cushion was also blended very well with my networking, with the pathways. So that whenever I switch between different nodes, I had a very sweet spot or a comfortable zone to enter them and to leave them. So this is built around these principles, and automation is very key of them. It's a key feature of all these listed features. Automation in the sense like you do extreme programming, you automate tests, right? Testing of your system, because you'll be moving very fast. Continuous delivery is very important, because you want, you will be continuous. Like we saw in the talk on no projects, right? The world is moving toward continuous delivery, continuous integration. So the focus is more on the transition rather than on the nodes. And an amazing fact about this is that now these nodes can be anything. They can change at their own pace, because now you have defined the backbone of your structure. These nodes can be, this thing I can outsource to a freelancer. This can be a framework which is already open source and I just plug it in, right? And this could be anything. This could be stubbed as well. This could be mocked as well, which is not built right now, but your interface is taking care of it. So your backbone remains the same, but your nodes keep on moving. That's what I learned from my experience. And there I was. I was just taking care of the networking, the connections between the nodes, which was built around single language. The language was of these concepts, these principles, not of any programming language. But why? Why do we need full stack developers in this industry? Any ideas? Just to summarize, debugging and diagnosis is easier, and the blame game cannot be played anymore, because there is one guy who knows something about other system, right? And you could, as a team, move forward. But there is another aspect to it. Let me know what you get out of this picture. Like, anybody who can guess what is this picture all about? Looks like your company? Organization? So, I'll just, ask you to imagine that this is an empire which everyone builds around their career. It could be a founder of a company, it could be an employee, it could be a product manager who has been building his empire by putting his hard work, his time, and he's always constantly building on top of it. But when you build your empire, you are in a competitive world, right? When you cannot guess that your competition can strike you from air, land, or water, right? You have to have someone in your team or in your empire who can sit at all the ends and can see and visualize where are the strengths and where are the weaknesses of your whole empire. It could be you, just you, because you know your empire the best. You're also a full stack developer, right? Looking at another way, this could be your allies or partners as well. They are roaming around, but you cannot figure out where they will fit into your system. If you're a startup, you need to partner with other startups, right? And this way, if you have a guy who knows the system end to end, he can, you know, guide you how you can integrate with your partners or your allies. So it's good for partnership, it's good for fighting competition, it is good for innovation. Innovation can happen in any area of your product or any area of your empire. And there should be one guy who knows that, yes, the innovation is happening in this direction, we should also take care of that, consider that thing. But where to start? Speaking is easy, right? How do you start? How do you start becoming a full stack developer? Everything starts at home. Like I said, I picked up projects from my neighborhood, from my family, right? You need to get time. You need to take out time for experimenting with other areas which you are not comfortable with. If you plan to become a full stack dev, you have to spend a lot of time in doing that. That is the pain. And the gain is that once you do this, if you are multitasking, this is not multitasking as in you are driving, you are handling a phone call, and you are drinking as well. I'm not talking about that multitasking, because that multitasking we learned in our childhood, holding a glass and taking a phone call. I'm telling about the the task which involve deep learning, deep creative thinking, which you oftenly shy of doing them. So once you keep doing them, you reach the next level of your subconsciousness. This all goes into your subconsciousness, and now you're ready for higher tasks. But this has to be a constant process. This concept is picked from a book called The Talent Code, right? It's based on how your mind works. There is a substance called myelin in your mind, which keeps on accumulating for the task you keep doing daily. And once it is done, it comes to your subconsciousness level, and then you are ready for the higher task, right? So you have to do deep learning tasks every day, right? Most of the people after job, they are not left with energy to pick up more creative tasks, right? But that is because we have been born and brought up in that culture. You have to kill that first, resistance to picking up a creative job. Start knowing your interests, where you are, your interests are. Like I didn't, I hated programming when I entered my industry, but I had to do full stack development. What helped me was before doing multitasking or full stack development in my career, I was doing multitasking in my regular life. Like I was, after coming from the job, I was going to gym, I was going to football, then I was going for piano lessons as well, right? And so these involved deep learning. Like a child is made to sit down and learn math, right? Initially he finds 2 + 2 is very difficult, but once he gets a hold on it, it becomes very easy for him. So it's all about muscle memory, practicing, and reaching the next level of subconsciousness. So I've talked about moving fast. How do you also have to move forward. Once you do have knowledge of all the domains or all the tools and developments around your area of work, how do you excel into them? How do you move forward with them? Because I could do it. I'm still moving forward with my learning. So moving forward is, I'll just give you an example. You can find parallel examples in other domains. I kept reading a lot of stuff about what is happening in and around the world. And you should not be reading published content. It should always be a two-way content. One-way published content is newspaper, TV. They just throw stuff on you. You have to read stuff which is on internet, because it is two-way. People are commenting on that. It is bad or not. It worked or not, right? So these are the sites for developers. This is Daily.js, which gives you good articles on what is happening in JavaScript. I picked JavaScript because it works on both client side and server side. It helped me as a tooling language. Then Twitter followed a lot of people who are on Twitter and SMEs, and they keep tweeting about what is happening recently in their own world and in their domain. Then there is github.com/explore. This is all the latest open source projects you will get here, which are trending on GitHub. And then there are, what I did was I used to go to online booksellers and see what are the latest books published there. This can happen in any domain, where the world is moving, where the expert people are writing books on, right? I went to Aureli in Apress and saw the technologies which were there listed for selling. Then also a good hack was to always update your profile on job websites, because the companies are always looking for the next thing. They're always looking to hire people who are working on the next thing. So I always kept, even I didn't want to switch jobs, I kept my resume updated. And I used to receive calls, like, we're looking for this guy, and I used to converse with them, like, okay, tell me about the product you are building. I wanted to know more interest. Like, they used to give me a lot of knowledge. So there I could judge that, yes, this technology will work in future, and I need to pick this up or integrate with my backbone, or even plan to integrate them into my backbone infrastructure. So a lot of learning from this. I'm open for questions. A stupid question is one which is not asked. Yes. After I put my skills on these websites, then I'm getting calls. Yes, exactly. Yes. This is one data point. No, you're living in a competitive world. There is no cheating in this. If you are satisfied, right, you didn't waste their time. They called you and you said you're not interested. Like, this worked for me. If your ethics don't allow, you can, opt out. As simple as that.
Maybe another way to be to search a possibility okay, for a 5 years experience, what is the thing that are going on? Details of the system that you are in that
way. Yeah.
Going that way.
Okay. Yes. So I would suggest, like, I'll repeat the question, that people in a company are already expertise in some area and they would not like to move to full stack development. How do you encourage them to become full stack developer? I would say that discuss a pet project with them, that you could start a personal project, and you can, for a company, inside company, it is not revenue based, but it should be in a different technology, because we want you to learn some new concepts, right? And this could be a personal project, and it could be a personal website. They will be encouraged that way, like Google does, right? They give 20% of their time to the developers, and they keep experimenting with new technologies, new open source projects. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Can we have a mic there? So the question still remains that people who want to remain expertise, they will not move because they see the advantage of being expert in some domain and industry wants that.
So we at Target pretty much, yeah, so we at Target pretty much doing on this journey for Agile and DevOps transformation, right? So one of the things that we are seeing that definitely some of the key people or some of the really technologists say, hey, you know what, I'm at, you know, on server side. I don't even want to move from to this technology because I have built 10 years into this technology. Now I am called principal technologist. So that's my core area. Now you're telling me to learn something else, so I will become diluted. So my value in market will go down, right? So we're kind of moving towards a T-shaped model that I just shared that with you. We are saying that, hey, we're not asking you to leave your technology, you know, expertise and drop it and start working something else, but it's always better to open up a little bit here and there on the both side where you are integrating with other systems, right? So a classical example I can share that we're working on a mobile app, and suddenly we're into Agile, we have committed for that sprint things to do, but then the UI guy didn't turn up, and then one bug came up which had to be critical to be delivered, and team felt so helpless at that point in time, saying that, hey, can we at least learn a little bit of it so that we can look into the code and do something? It won't be your core work. It's not that from tomorrow we'll ask you to develop UI, but still, you know, we need to have some sort of cross training or cross skills across the team so that I'm sure he's talking about the full and, you know, total stack develop, you know, ownership, but then at least the T-shape will start opening up. You should start at least be able to look into some queries and look at the database side, something on the UI side. So it's just an approach that we are taking.
Actually, same thing happened to my team, you know. So there was a protracted test where we write for Angular JS, and, you know, nobody took it because the guy, you know, did not turn, and they were not aware of the technology. They are all Java developers, mm-hmm. and, you know, backend developers. So
yeah.
This is where, you know, we see a lot of need for full stack developer. Just
yeah.
like as I said, you know, it's a small thing that you need to know. You should be able to understand what is the issue and you should be able to fix it.
Yeah.
So that's totally different from what you are talking about. You know, full stack developer means you should at least know, you know, basic level of in all the areas.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If a person is arguing about that he has been in some particular language for a while and is not able to shift, you should talk about the principles. It's not about language anymore. All the languages are converging into some similar standard, which was not there 5 years ago. Everybody was going their own way. Now, Apple, Google, Microsoft, they are driving the new languages to a similar standard and similar tooling. And that's why we have a lot of people who have experience more than 10 years. They are not ready to shift to new standard, but new guys are ready to pick up all the technologies because they started their learning when the standard was about to set.
I just want to share something. So in our organization, we also follow Agile, and we have like 4-5 teams. One of the team's responsibility is like partial product support. So they are the mainstream team who does their development, full course development. And but if there is production support that is required, they go ahead and do all the bug fixing. We have a lead for that team. We usually don't have anybody other than Scrum Masters, right? But we kept for that team a lead, somebody who's a full stack developer. The idea behind that was to make it faster. So when a issue comes from production, you don't need to have multiple people look into it. This guy puts his hand into it. He stops his development, he put his hands into it. He finds out the issue. If it's something that it's fixable by him, he does it. Unless he needs his UI developer or a specialized backend developer to put his hand into it, he makes sure that the regular work of the sprint is not hindered. So that way, having specialized people is very good. At the same time, full stack developers are always a plus point. He does his regular job as a full backend developer as well. So that's a plus point.
Yeah. So it should be a separate person. You cannot move an expert to a full stack dev. You have a question, right? We have a question before. I think you're trying to say that we have center of excellence people in one company and there is a project, right? And you're trying to relate that this guy is managing the employees, right? And yeah. Yeah. So have you created opportunities for him to move to different areas? Yes. So that's what I'm saying, that you cannot transition a person who has been working in some way into a full stack developer instantly, because this is a very painful and a slow process. It has to be in your subconsciousness. So you have to have that culture from the start for a person to work. That's why new guys are picking this up. A lot of freelancers do this because they have to survive. Yeah. Yes. We have a question, Prolo. Yeah. Sorry.
So the question is like, when is it the right time for a developer to understand, okay, now I can get into the concept of full stack development?
Yesterday. It was yesterday. Sure. Yeah, yes. I'll just add to that, there are a lot of tools which transpile from one language to another. You should start using them in your company. In this way, they will start entering the era of full stack development and they will not feel the initial resistance. Yeah.
So there was the same challenge I had when I was trying to hire a test developer.
Yeah.
So everybody was in the consulting area. So do you need an automation engineer or a tester or a developer? I said no, I need a test developer. So I have my prescription. There is a test developer who should be able to develop and test.
Mm-hmm.
So finally, we end up transforming existing automation engineers to a test developer, developer to a test.
So just to add to that, there is an article which is called Full Stack Developer is a Myth. You should try to read that. Actually, there is no concept as full stack developer. Actually, you're looking for rock stars. You should have in the job description, we are looking for rock stars. And while interviewing them, you should see how he can make the switches, not what expert he is. He should be switching very easily between different problems.
To a greater extent about the culture, and the gentleman at the back was talking about how their organization is designed in a way where you have center of excellence, and that's where exactly 6 months back Target was, right? But now we have literally redesigned, and we have now pivoting around the productized team. So you are owner of a product, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it has been really redesigned in that, breaking all the COEs and saying that, hey, these are the product teams. So now you start looking at the product.
Yes.
No more project, no more program, nothing. This is the product that has to be shipped out.
Distributed ownership.
Yeah, and when you own that search piece, for example, on target.com, you own that search product. And then now whatever stack is needed, whatever these 10 people have to deliver, it's like you have to self-sustained unit. There is nobody from testing team which will give you a tester. So I had the same challenge. I was managing the testing COE before this transition happened. So everybody like, hey, I am the automation tester. And developers were saying, yeah, I don't want to do testing. You are asking me to write what? TDD? You want me to write test cases?
Yeah.
You know, it's a huge mindset kind of thing.
Yes,
but yeah,
yes.
It's a journey. It's
yeah, it's a slow journey.
Yeah.
We have a question from this gentleman. Yeah.
Thank you. Regarding the full stack development, as we think about the management perspective, it sounds great for them actually, for the managers and all. But when I think regarding the developer, suppose I'm a developer right now, and I'm thinking about the switching different tools and different languages to have a full straight face knowledge, right? So, you know, suppose I'm now I have a 4 or 5 years of experience, I'm switching to different languages, right? And now there's a requirement from other companies. Why do they take me for that particular language? Because I'm a, you can say, 6 month of experience, they will hire a fresher because they need to pay less with respect to me, right?
Mm-hmm.
So it's like master of all trade, but jack of all trade, master of none.
Yeah,
right.
it's like jack of all trades and master of being jack of all trades. So right. So you should, if you do, like I said, you have to. The companies who ask for language skills, I'll suggest don't go for them. They should ask for these principles: continuous delivery, rest, authentication, how authentication works, the concepts, how indexing works in a database. You should know that. If you know that, you can pick any language in a week or a two.
Eventually, you will become a full stack. You won't become a full stack in 3 years, 4 years. Maybe Rajat can say, so you've been there in the industry for 6 years.
But you said that they have appointed one full stack developer, right? You know, I think it will be myself or 20 or 30 people at least, but they are appointing only one full stack, not a full stack.
That's just one data point that you are talking about.
So it depends from team to team. We have that gentleman, yeah. Yeah.
Stand out, but eventually knowing everything will help you,
yes.
Get all things.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
You're not talking about the languages and all. Again, the concept. Thank you.
So last 5 minutes. Yeah, sometimes it is difficult. I agree with that. But this is like a discussion on full stack developer. A counter argument would be that you should have more incubation or the new small projects in your company which are including full stack development processes. They are not going into your legacy system, but they are going into your new innovations or the new projects which you are incubating inside your company. Those could be built on the newer technologies. And if you have followed the guiding principles and all the design patterns in your legacy code, it would be very easy for them to transition to the legacy system. Yes. 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 Yes, that is it. Yeah, sure. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Sure, sure.
All of us, including me, were on next platform. And now that guy is not there. Two of us work on Angular and Java. One is still on old Java and he knows the flavor of Angular. And one guy is working with database, Java, and Angular. So we've transformed in ourselves into, you know, taking up small things and taking those steps and getting into that.
Yeah. Another thing is, yeah, pair programming or code reviews between different languages. This will help them bridge the gap.
I totally agree with your point that you are very uncomfortable. No one core competency, but yeah, that's the way forward, I think, and that's how.
Yeah, I just say love. Yeah. But is full stack contagious? I mean, can I pair program with somebody and become a full stack engineer, right? I could be a beginner, but if I'm pairing with somebody, is it contagious enough where I can pick it up?
So one way to identify is that, like this lady said, you should not be pushing to an employee that you should learn some new technology. The guy should be coming to you. I want to do something else. Like, there you identify, and then you create an environment for him, like pair programming or code reviews. You see that this guy has the fire to become a full stack dev.
I think that's what it should be. I think quite often, and I could be making a huge assumption over here, and pardon me if I am, but don't work for a client. Work for yourself.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly. Exactly.
For crying out loud, right? I mean, let's just stop doing that, right? Just because the requirement is that or the client wants that is not what we should be thinking. I'm invested in myself. I mean, I always say, like, you know, every year invest 10% of my earning in my own learnings, right? Let me go and learn new things. I don't care if my employer or my client needs this or not. I need this, right? And take those ideas back to your wherever your teams are and say, hey, we could do this better. And if your quote unquote client doesn't understand it, then they're stupid enough. And I think that's a sign that you should leave them. But not everybody's in that position.
Yeah.
Best thing is if the company
is what you want. Invest in yourself and become.
Cool. I think we are done with the time. So it's good. Thank you.